Thank you all for coming in. So wanted to give a quick introduction in terms of the device that we are looking at. I am part of Bionic Yantra. Bionic Yantra is a startup, and we have built what we call as a robotic assisted rehabilitation device. We call it REARS for short. This is the device which is visible in front of you. The whole journey started when one of the founders had a family member who was injured and who was not able to walk. He had a spinal cord issue and he found it difficult to walk, and that's where the journey started. And over a period of time, it came to the point wherein they realized that this is a problem that potentially can be solved. There are other instances in the US wherein they're building exoskeletons, robotic devices, etc., and they realized this is something that can be solved. So it's a journey that started 3 years ago. And 3 years ago, they set up a company, a startup. They talked to multiple hospitals. They talked to multiple doctors. And given that background, they started off the journey of building this whole device. Primarily, the device is what we call as an exoskeleton. It helps people who are spinal cord injured or stroke, etc., to help them get up and walk again. Two, three unique definitions. In the US, when they have an exoskeleton, it is only this part of the device. It doesn't have the body weight support system. So it takes them a while to stand up and walk and stuff, right? Given the fact that we are from India, given the fact that we always find alternate solutions to everything, the center of gravity shift was the biggest problem, and we avoided the whole problem by putting a body weight support system. So body weight support system helps a patient wherein they put on a jacket, we lift him up, and now he's completely ready to come back and start walking. So we have an early intervention. They can start off much earlier, and it helps in multiple different ways. Not only spinal cord and stroke, but for knee surgery, a whole bunch of other cases as well. Right? The device, the uniqueness of the device has been patented. It's been granted a US patent, and it's completely designed ground up from India. Right? So there's no technology that we inherited. There's nothing that we got. Obviously, we were inspired. You know, we stood on the shoulders of other giants. We were inspired by what others did, but completely ground up design in India that we have built and that we're taking to the world. Right? We'd like to thank IIITB in terms of the partnership that we have with them. It's been very encouraging in terms of saying this is an area that we would like to work together, to do research together, and to try out a whole bunch of other things together. So to start off, I'd like to do two things. One, I'd like to quickly show a video. It's a video of when we got our first patient onto the device who got up and walked. It's the story of Samir. Samir was a person who, at the age of 30, met with a bike accident and broke his spinal cord. And he was 38 when he got onto the device, and at that point, for 8 years, he had not stood up and walked. Right? And when we interacted with him, put him onto the device, it was the first instance wherein, by himself, he could stand up and walk. Right? I'd like to quickly start off in terms of showing a video of what this device was meant to be.
Hi, I'm Samir Alupati. I'm a IT profession. I was quite active family person, love to go out with my family. I met with a road traffic accident which made me paraplegic. Still, I dream of walking.
The first generation was to provide a fall safe walk, though not on the ground, and partial unloading of the patient's weight. The second generation was the exoskeleton, enabling on ground walking. This, however, does not provide fall safe walking. REARS is the first third generation technology combining the advantages of the first two generations.
A base device is kind of a launch pad for new ideas that haven't even, you know, been possible before.
The advantage of the REARS system is it's three devices in one. When Bionic Yantra came up with this brilliant idea of making a device which can easily fit across the disease spectrum and is affordable, there was no question of us not wanting to work with them. One of the things which the device does is provide onboard sensors to real-time collect clinical outcome measures, but also metrics which therapists would do in note-taking. And all of this data is in real-time upload to a cloud server, where machine learning algorithms can analyze this information, come up with prediction models, will help them guide the treatment session.
natural work. That I never felt for the last 8 years.
This team has been able to design a fully functional device in less than 2 years is incredible. This was completely designed within India.
Every time we see the video, we're reminded of the fact that we are doing a bunch of technology, we are doing a bunch, you know, building up a device, creating a startup. But the whole purpose is what the video mentioned, which is a world without wheelchairs. Right? We sincerely believe that anybody who is injured, we have the ability to come back and help them walk again. It takes a lot of stuff. We are still at the early stages in terms of, you know, getting some of them rehabilitated. But it's a long journey. And as part of this journey, even though we, you know, do a whole bunch of technology and stuff, it also has a lot of involvement from the medical fraternity. So I'd like to invite, you know, Dr. Maheshwarappa from Sakra Hospital to speak a few words in terms of how the doctors perceive something like, you know, how the medical fraternity perceives something like these kind of a technologies. Right?
I am Dr. Maheshwarappa, working as a consultant in Sakra World Hospital. I took my specialty as a rehabilitation, though I was able to get many other specialties. So I was interested in managing the disability and people with the disability and how to make change in their quality of life. To go back to, say, almost I'm third decade I'm in this field. So when we started my MD, so we were driven completely, the last 3 decades, first decades, we were completely dependent on patients manually doing exercise for the patient with the stroke, spinal cord injury, and the head injuries. And also, it is completely manual. There was no technology at all. So patient with the paralyzed below the neck, almost literally 5 people, 2 holding their legs and 2 holding the hand, and 1 person supporting from the waist. So that was the stage we used to work with the patients to make him at least to an extent of standing. So that was the difficult time. And the next stage, what we saw is something like there's a hoist with a frame with the hoist, where patient is tied and then make him stand. And then 2 physiotherapists will be moving his legs, keep on moving, and then 1 physiotherapist will be holding his along with the waist to prevent the fall. Third decade, what I saw is the technology like this, which really the future of the patients with the disabilities. Not only disability, this technology has in the health industry has made huge change. Any specialty we analyze with the technology. It can be just mental illness or it can be physical illness. When we started studying MBBS, it was taught that once brain is damaged, spinal cord is damaged, it can never be repairable and patient is going to be comatose, patient is going to be bedridden, and with bedridden, with complications, he is going to die. The patient who becomes bedridden, we know that 101 medical complications will be waiting to catch him, and the purpose is to kill him. And patient, we never saw patient surviving with spinal cord injury for a decade, 5 years, 10 years. Today, with this technology, can definitely make person live as long as the normal person can live, or maybe something more than that can live, maybe few more years more, because rest of the people are exposed to accidents, trauma, injury, fall. But these patients are not exposed to that. That is the technology in the future. So person with a disability can live more number of years than the person who's leading a normal life. That is going to be the future. So having said that, why this made change in the nervous system, whether it's the spinal cord or the brain? When earlier research, if you go back to 50, 60 years, when the rat is artificially cut the spinal cord and given a cylinder, it is hanged and made him to move, made the rat to move the legs, and it was known it starts regenerating the nerves in the spinal cord, which can start connecting with the uninjured area and then establish connection. That's called neural circuit. So same applied in the human being, like what has shown in the animals, but maybe this is a little more difficult, but taking more number of days, months, year to get connection. So what we call it is called neuronal plasticity and neuro regeneration. So neuronal plasticity, neuronal regeneration happens when person is exposed to the focused exercise, functional exercise. This is what it does, this robot. It gives physiological, normal physiological pattern of gait movements so that the spinal cord takes this stimulus and gets the parallelly undamaged nerves, starts sprouting, sending the dendrites, and makes a connection with the remaining the injured area, and then establish sensation, motor recovery, that is the strength coming back, sensation coming back, and then coordination and balance coming back. So these are the things are positively seen in the research, that this can make a huge change in the motor recovery and the sensory recovery. And along with that, in medical science, we do use something like three things. One is robotic assisted rehabilitation and a lot of research, and there is the neurotropics, where we give a medicine so that it can make these the injured cells can gain, they recover and then make connection, and also sometimes called cells, that is called stem cells. There are a lot of stem cells research is happening, and injecting these stem cells into the spinal cord, injecting neurotrophic cell factors into the area, and also involving this robotic assisted rehabilitation can make a spinal cord the injured spinal cord or brain cells to recover more and more and make connection, so that all the system in the brain and spinal cord can be improved along with the locomotion. Locomotion is one part of it. If a person trains spinal cord injury, he can even bladder becomes better, because bladder cells are completely different, ambulation is different. But when you have seen patient starts walking with this steps, making a steps, and the bladder sensation improves, bowel sensation improves, and there's so many things are improving, and thereby it can prevent many other complication like spasticity and bed sore development and blood clot developing in the legs. And so similarly, and bone strength improves, muscle strength comes back. So there are so many 101 benefits physiologically, functional recovery has shown this. So normally 3 decades back, we could make patient to take 10 steps with 5 people assistance, and the second decade we made maybe about 20 steps taking in 1 hour, 30 steps in 1 hour. But this robot can make, and this similar to that, I am just talking about the parallel to this, there are robots now in the world, so which I worked with and which I have seen, and that is a stationary. Those robots which only patient on treadmill, it makes him walk, and it can make in 20 minutes 1200 steps. That is what we need brain to and spinal cord to recover. So it makes about 1200 steps in 20 minutes. That is the driven exercise for the legs to get best results, which we could last 2 decades we have not done that. Now similar to that, if patient walks about 40-45 minutes, it takes about 2000 plus steps. That is the extent of rehabilitation with the lower limb rehabilitation required with the robotic assisted technology. And the compared to rest of the robots, which are the static one which is just you can operate only on the treadmill. Other one is you can wearable robot. You can wear robots and walk. And that is not much advanced, and very few patients are using in the world. But comes to this, this is the robot which is Indian made, and which I did a, we did in a research, the pilot study in Sakra World Hospital. Little more earlier version of this, this is the second version. There we could make the patient the wear the donning of, that is wearing of this robot for in 6 minutes, taking steps about 15 initial few days about 50 meter and later on nearly about 100 meter. So the advantage of this, and where we could not do that in Sakra World Hospital, but this robot came, made them to walk about nearly 100 meters. That's a big thing for the doctors. Same way, this is going to be what I expect, and look at the robot assisted technology for my patients. One, you should be able to do the job of getting about nearly 2,000, 3,000 steps on the treadmill. This has scope for that. Plus taking it onto the ground where patient can walk about kilometer, 1.5 kilometer with this. Third, if during this period, about say 3 months to 4 months, we have a crucial time where the faster recovery of brain and spinal cord happens. During that is the time what we required. After that, it is not that it stops at that time after 4 months, but it continues to recover. Even after 1 year, 2 years, we have seen patients recovering. So this robot, suppose after 4 months patient doesn't improve, then we need to have a wearable robot. Only these two parts can be used so that patient can walk back to the home with the robot. At least he will be functionally independent in walking. So not only the spinal cord injury, head injury, stroke, and the patients are used the day one, or maybe once patient is stable, that means in the ICU itself, patients coming out from stroke, going to the ward, we can fit this from the ICU itself, we can make a patient to walk if he's clinically stable. And that angle, patient, the future of this stroke patient lying in a in the ICU, walking back to home, it's a huge change in his life and in the medical science. So similarly, the relatively there are so many, any patient, whether it's a neuro, ortho, or any, if he is weak, he cannot walk, this is the ideal machine, device to use them. So suppose patient has a, both bones are broken and operated, but he cannot stand. Doctor says, no, you cannot make him stand because it's operated and fractured. Then we don't have anything to make him walk. But the device, the harness completely takes off his load and makes him walk. Hardly any, just he will be just touching the ground and walking. So these are the things are required, and these are the devices going to make change in the future, and technology is the, health is the technology in the future, and I congratulate our Bionic Yantra and the team which have come out with such a wonderful product and which is going to help my patient which has been working last 3 decades. Thank you so much for giving that.
Thank you for those encouraging words. So one of the things that happens is, you know, doctors, clinicians, medical people give us enough challenges in terms of what we have to do. We are also blessed with one more opportunity, which is, in a journey like this, it's a very long journey, right? So you get up, there's a whole bunch of challenges to face. You need a purpose, you need a dream towards which you can work, right? And without that, it becomes too mundane in terms of what you're doing. So one of the things that has happened is we've been blessed with the advice of Dr. Kedar, and I'd like to invite Dr. Kedar to share his dream, which is what keeps us going as part of this whole journey.
Thank you, Professor. Thank you, Naresh, for joining. Before I start my dream, I want to tell a lot of people, I became a startup at 64. Right? I'm touching 68, People always ask me, I run around. In fact, from here I ran around, actually you had a problem walking with me. Lot of people say, what do you eat, what do you drink, what is your brand? I think somebody should use that as a marketing tool. But anyhow, every day, morning till night, I eat, I drink a dream which is shared between me and Professor Shadgopan. The dream is actually giving me the energy. Before the dream, I also want to tell you that today it's a machine which has some intelligence. We have brought him as a student to Professor Shadgopan to increase its brain power little more. Please add little more gray, because rehab is much, much, much complicated. So that is the reason why we have come to you. Please think that this is a patient, student, and you have to teach him some brain. So that because software behind it, and behind the software, the AI, ML, whatever today you are using the term, that is very critical, because the rehabilitation depends on the type of population set, age, background, whether he was a sportsman, military, etc., the type of injury that has happened, the age, gender, everything, it depends. And the type of injuries also vary several times, like he has said. It's a complex combination, and I think if you put a matrix, it may run 1 million columns, 1 million row. That is the type of things, is because gait is unique. The way I walk, way Praveen walks, totally different. Okay, now what is it that is making me run around like a mad fellow at this age? I have a dream. I worked in cabinet secretariat. I have been exposed to uniform men. Of course, incidentally, in my family, a lot of people are also connected to uniform men. So I've seen a lot of them. And I have seen more than 50,000 uniform men who are in the wheelchair today. And the greatest man of the person today in India is wheelchair is Lieutenant General Razdani. He was the Lieutenant General of the paratroopers for last 8 years. Like Samir, he's on the wheelchair. Okay, now I'll just tell my dream. He told that little bit rehabilitation, some of them may be rehabilitated, thanks. If they are not rehabilitated, I don't want any of these uniform men to be in the wheelchair. They have not drunk and they have got into an accident. They are not got into any brawl. One, they have fallen because a bullet has gone into their spinal, or a splinter has gone into theirs, because they have put their foot everywhere close to mines. They have fallen when they were scaling up. So in the call of the duty, they have fallen, right? So my dream is none of them, world without wheelchairs for Praveen is a bigger. For me, the subset is 50,000 uniform men today who are in the wheelchair. 50,000 about 8-9 years ago, it must have now increased. Every year, 1,500 are put to wheelchair. Okay, now January 26, 2022. Thanks to Professor, thanks to him. You know that Vijay Path, the great Republic Day parade happens. I think some of you must have seen it. Okay, in that parade, there will be one special platoon, thanks to Professor Shadgopan and Dr. Kedar. So on that day, under the leadership of Lieutenant General Razdan, 30 uniform men are sitting in a wheelchair, of course, wearing this under this one, what we call exoskeleton. They are being pushed by the caretakers, and they come in front of the VIPs in the dais. And for every parade, there is a starting point here. One flag is put. At that time, you must have seen, they turn right and salute the VIPs. And then there is another one. At that, they close, then they start looking. So that is called the salute zone. When the platoon comes here in the wheelchair, being pushed by the earlier caretakers. So these people suddenly stand up. Thanks to the device, which is going to be more intelligent, they start making a march past. They leave the wheelchair behind, and the empty wheelchair come behind them, symbolically that they have left their wheelchair behind. They salute on the dais to the VIPs, and threw them to the nation. They salute the nation, nation salutes them. So that is the dream that I want to. After that, I think I may need a lot of Bournevita or Horlicks, but till that time, I'll have all this energy. I want on January 26th, a platoon of uniform men going out of the wheelchair and doing this. And that is called Startup India VR, Made in India, Stand Up India. Truly Stand Up India of the persons who have lost their spinal cord in the call of the duty of the nation. Thank you.
So that's the dream that keeps us going. That's the process behind it. Obviously, it's a long journey. I'd like to now invite Professor Chakupan and Dr. Kedar. Where Dr. Kedar hands over the device and inaugurates the device.
Thank you all and good afternoon. It's a very special day today because I think three strands of thought are coming together, kind of a Triveni. So we at IIITB always felt that we should use the cutting edge technology, bleeding technology, to make a difference to people. And I think Bionic Yantra represents the true spirit of IIITB. We will use cutting-edge technology, but we need to make a difference. What can be a better demonstration of our true spirit of IIITB? The institute, we always look for win-win partnerships. We do sign MOUs, we have student exchange, occasionally faculty exchange, occasionally a student and a faculty work together with the students and faculty there. All of them are important, but we were looking for something where we genuinely add value to each other, and then we complement our strengths truthfully. And we discovered NIMHANS. So the director of NIMHANS will be with us on 27th, where we will do the one more next stage of this. And I think we also have a very visible demonstration of this partnership. We have Dr. Vikas, a neurosurgeon, formerly doing a PhD in computer science at IIITB. Okay, I did something special to Dr. Vikas. Are you around, Vikas? No, you're supposed to be there. See, normally, you know, we do have our PhD students. I actually kind of greet them on their comprehensive because it's an important stage in PhD. For Dr. Vikas, I actually took him out for lunch. Okay, so I said, because it is so important, honestly speaking, I was a little worried because, you know, medical students don't generally have the sufficient amount of math background. Will he pass the comprehensive was always my worry. He passed it. So in a sense, NIMHANS has been, and people like Srikanth spend, Jaya, they spend so much time in NIMHANS. And many of the NIMHANS doctors spend time. The second PhD student is going to enroll soon. So it is a true win-win partnership. The third thing, you know, people used to ask me, why do you have three eyes? Of course, Dr. Kedar kind of people will say you should always have three eyes because that is what Kedarnath is supposed to be all, right? But the third eye of IIITB from day one was always the innovation and entrepreneurship. So creating genuine value, creating genuine startups was something which has been in the DNA of the institute from day one. And we are happy, of course, Gautam is not here. Even from the very first batch, we had one startup. And the startup survives today, okay? So in a sense that Bionic Yantra is our partner. So we are partnering amongst the faculty in terms of research. You know, this is robotics, there'll be much more AI, there'll be a lot more ML. We partner with doctors like Dr. Maheshappa. We are also going to get Dr. Hegde very soon, okay? So we'll have doctors, we have NIMHANS, but it's also important to create value. And so when our friends from Bionic Yantra came, I said, look, this is precisely what we need to do, okay? And the fact that whatever technology which we develop makes a difference through a device which is made by a startup, which is kind of incubated at IIITB, gives me the maximum satisfaction. So I feel so happy, and I think all the three strands come together. And I think, Dr. Kedar, special thanks to you because you are a person who make all of us dance. We'll keep dancing, okay? It is important because one day he walked into my office in his inimitable style, and this is precisely what he said. And we said, yes, we are partnering. And of course, we did show it in BTS, and it became a talk of the town. So I think we have a long way to go. And I think special thanks to the people of Bionic Yantra. 6 years now, at least, right? Yes, so it's good. And remember that this, they say it's a long journey. So it will be 30 years. But you will make a difference to, just not to 50,000 people, maybe to 300,000 people. I think that is a satisfaction. Thank you.
So we'll just do the preparation for the demo. In the meantime, I'd like to invite Professor to give us a few words in terms of the impact of something like robotics and what they do as part of the Windows Center here.
So to start with, I have a bone to pick with Professor Sadgopan. He never took me out for lunch when I came and joined back as a student. So something I need to take it up with him. So, you know, like it's, there's something called coincidences, right? So the day I remember I came and spoke to Professor expressing that I want to come back to academics and leave the corporate life, we had a discussion and he said, just wait, there's somebody called Kedar coming. And I met Kedar for the first time, and it so happened that the previous day, if you recollect, Mindro was signed and we had that money to kind of go ahead and do that. So it was like three things coming together. It was a nice coincidence. But without taking too many, just drop a few data points for you. Professor John Medina, who wrote the famous book called Brain Rules, he's a microbiologist, heavily interested in genetics, writes about, and his definition of human being is that we are designed, we are machines, which are designed to think while moving. And he's done tons of experiments on kids across the world to show that if children stop moving, their executive skills, their math skills, their communication skills drop. And he's actually shown that when you put them back on treadmills, literally, the skills go up. And his famous word is, if it was left to me, I will have a gym room next to every classroom in every school that I have. So just imagine if you are a machine who is designed to think while moving. That's your job, thinking while moving. 1 billion people in this earth today have mobility problems. 1 billion people, right? You all know how many people there are on earth, right? About 7 to 8 billion people, if I'm not mistaken. 1 billion people have mobility problems. That's 1 out of 7 people that we know are not functioning to their fullest extent. Just think about what the impact devices like this, research on this, can have on humankind. The second one, I think, you know, like everybody has their own thing, working with Bionic for some time. You know, like Praveen talks about world without wheelchairs. Kedar has this really grand vision of Rajpath. For me, the one that really kind of makes me continue to work for them, and it's really important that IIIT figures out a way to make this more intelligent, as Kedar says. There are a few functions of human life that we take for granted. The most basic ones, right? Passing waste from our body. Absolutely the basic one. Just think of a patient with C4, C7 injury. Just ask yourself, how do they do it? And without getting too much into gory details, just the fact that these machines and some of the new technologies that's coming through can put back dignity to human life, right? This is beyond the 50,000 on walking. Right? This is beyond soldiers which having grand, just basic human dignity. If these machines can allow you to put back, and the research is starting to show, and Mashrapa could be, could, you know, like comment on it, the physiological changes that good therapy can provide to people who've lost some of those physiological controls is just massive. So for me, that giving back that dignity to potentially 1 billion people is what I think makes this device such an important one. It's important that we succeed in our vision. Thanks, everyone.
One of the things that also happens as part of this device, like
multiple people have mentioned, this device is right now at a very early stage. Now think of it like, you know, a kid which is still trying to grow. Today it's a robotic device. The device does what we tell. If we tell it, you know,
see, MS DOS 1.0.
MS DOS 1.0.
Yeah.
So that's the state it is in. And with all the things that you see, it is still at that state. Right? So today it's a device wherein, you know, we can give it a date format, we can customize it for different people and stuff, and it will do what we tell it. But in most human conditions, we want it to work with the humans, not just, you know, as a device that we put on the humans. Right? So in that sense, you know, forgetting all the hoopla of Iron Man, forgetting all the fancy devices that you see out there, there's a lot of utility for the device to be closely associated with the patient in terms of saying for each patient, the way it has to behave will end up being slightly different. Right? So we believe that going forward, there's a lot of data that we need to collect about the patients and stuff. There's a lot of data that we need to look at from a brain profile. And there's a lot of suggestions and recommendations that you can come back and make. Obviously, we're in very early stages of that, but that's again a very long journey that we have in terms of ensuring that the patient and the device work together in terms of rehab. I'd like to invite Professor Raghavan to give a few words in terms of his understanding of the device and the data and the kind of things that.
Yeah, it's fantastic to work with a device like this, which, as Tridib said, puts motion back into people's lives. So I'm going to talk about what we can do with the data that this generates beyond the ML AI hype. I really hope we can actually do some serious data analysis to put some real value into the device. I mean, based on my limited understanding, I got a dump of what the device does and what sort of data can be potentially collected from Praveen a few days ago. So I have some thoughts on what we can potentially do with this, with the data that this device generates. At the most basic level, there seems to be a lot of gap in the standardization of and even profiling of patients. Like, what does when a patient is trying to walk, even setting a goal on what should the patient come back to, because we have very little data about how the patient used to be walking before the mishap or the accident occurred, right? So even setting the goal, coming up with some sort of standardized profiles which at the best must be customized to the patient, or at least it must be sensitive to the demographics in which the patient is living, right? So, I mean, you can't apply some standard that is applicable to somebody in, say, a Norwegian country to someone who's living in India. So there is a serious lack of data on how do you profile patients, how do you set goals, how do you set standards, and so on and so forth. So at the least, that's one thing that we can start driving towards. The moment we get some data from real patients or even normal people when they try walking with the device, the sort of data that you collect will help you come up with some sort of segmentation, profiling, creating some normalized walking profiles for people in a certain demographic. So that's the most basic level of data analysis that you can do. The next level would be, this is still a passive thing. I'm just collecting data, segmenting it, and creating some sort of a classification, right? We can try moving beyond that into slightly more active sort of protocols, where another important thing, I mean, something that I was quite surprised about, which Praveen told me a few days ago. I believe a lot of the rehabilitation that happens today for patients actually doesn't go too far, simply because patients don't turn up. I mean, they go through the, so they have planned out maybe 15 sessions, and the patient comes for 2-3 sessions and then they just drop out, right? And the primary reason for the dropout, and the dropout rates are apparently very, very high, as high as maybe 70-80%, right? And the primary reason why these dropout rates are so high is, I believe, because there are no metrics. There is no way to show the patient that there is some improvement happening. A lot of the dropout seems to be because they just give up. They say, well, I don't see anything improving, so what is the point, sort of, right? Now, having data and then building some metrics on top of the data can actually help a lot in motivating patients to continue with the therapy till they're actually fully okay, right? So you can actually set some milestones and say, look, you're 30% okay now, you're 50%, 60%, whatever, right? So you can actually set some milestones, and there will be some visible progress which the patient can relate to. Today, in the way therapy is given, we don't have the means to be able to give them objective, quantitative milestones that they can shoot for. And so hopefully having some data and generating some sensible metrics out of it can actually help patients in continuing with the therapy till the end. Okay, so these two would be the more passive things. Yeah, so far it's only pure data analysis. You can actually get into serious ML and AI sort of thing where you based on data, but then that would be quite some distance away. I mean, after we get enough data, we should be hopefully able to come up with ways to design protocols. Meaning, so given a patient, how at what rate? So what sort of milestones do you set? I mean, everything is done manually by experienced therapists today, but can that be at least partially automated, which is hopefully a lot more customized to the patient, and it is sensitive to the progress that the patient is making, right? So you can actually get into active designing of protocols for patients. And then the last stage would be to actually feed into the engineering of the device itself, right? Where you, based on the analysis, then the device becomes more intelligent about how it treats the patient who has been strapped onto the machine. So there are several levels at which we can address the problem, but the last two would actually require serious amount of AI ML research, because before you can put these algorithms there and leave a patient at the mercy of this algorithm, the algorithm actually needs to have something provable about it. I mean, you can't simply say, look, I'm going to put a patient here because my algorithm has 98% accuracy. That simply doesn't make sense. You need to have some way of guaranteeing that the algorithm is not going to do any damage, at the least, right? So that, I think, is going to require a lot of research in terms of ML/AI and actually generating guarantees for these algorithms that you build on top of the data that you have here. And then, of course, looking far ahead, you can do a lot of multimodal stuff, like you can have some vision-based data to see the expressions on the patient's face, to look at the pain level and all that. You can maybe even have some maybe ECG or EEG sort of recordings to see exactly what is happening in the brain or maybe in the rest of the nervous system while this therapy is going on, and that can be correlated with the data that you collect from the joint. So there can be all sorts of things that can be done. So it is a long road ahead, and hopefully we will be able to let Dr. Kedar live his dream. Okay, thank you.
What we'd like to do is to show a quick demo in terms of the capabilities of the device. In introduction to that, we've got what we call as the VWS. VWS is the frame that you see outside, and it's something that holds the patient up. Right? So in this case, luckily, Vikram is part of our team, he's not a patient, he's an able-bodied person. But even for a patient, it holds him up, it can unveil him, and it can help them in terms of doing multiple things, what we call as protocols. So for example, we'll be demoing a single step walk, wherein we do one step at a time. We'll be showing a continuous walk, where the patient by themselves can come back and walk continuously. We'll be showing a slow and a fast walk. And in between, we'll also be showing what we call a sit to stand protocol. They can come back and the device will help them in terms of sitting down and standing down. These are just a few protocols. Given the same hardware, we can come back and add a whole bunch of protocols. And all these protocol calls can also be varied in terms of speed, other variations, etc. They can also be varied and customized for the patients as well. Right? So let's go through a quick round of demo.
Okay, so the step-by-step walking is where the therapist or the person who's controlling using the tab will initiate every step of the movement. This is needed at the initial phase when someone's donning the exoskeleton for the first time. It could be an overwhelming experience. So to take it slow, they have to get used to the device. So for that, initially we start with a step-by-step walking. And once the patient is comfortable with the device, then we can also use this phase for getting training with the weight shifting. And once they're comfortable with that, they'll be able to continuously take steps and move ahead with the exoskeleton by themselves. Now, we'll start with the step-by-step walking,
As an initial part of the protocol, so we'll use some part of the unwinding. So based on the patient, we can vary that amount of unwinding that the patient will be needing. That can be decided by the therapist. So I'm right now unwinding some around 20 kgs of load from the patient. And once the configuration is done, the robot in itself can follow with the exoskeleton. So there is no amount of push or pull needed by the patient side. So I'll initiate the step. So you do a left weight shift.
Left weight shift.
In the first step. So this right now what we are showing is a slow walk, slow speed walk. So initial part of the assessment, patient will get used to the speed. Right shift, next step.
So every step is being initiated by Kostu from the controller.
Yes. Right shift, next step.
So you are not walking, the robot is walking.
Yes, so.
So it's the same experience for a person who is completely paralyzed from the waist down and he cannot stand up and walk at all. Even when we have put such patients through, the therapist controls in terms of the walk
and step. Yeah. Okay.
So now we'll show the auto trigger part. So once he's, the patient has gotten used to the whole system, he's aware of it, we'll be using his postural cues to trigger the next steps. So auto trigger.
Okay.
So there are certain thresholds wherein the machine will sense that and initiate the steps. So you can do a.
Okay. So to take the first step, I have to do a lateral weight shift, a left weight shift. So that indicates that I am doing a weight shift, and it has to be an intent to move by the patient. So I have to hold that patient that position for about 1 second, and then it registers that okay, there is an intent to move. And there's another cue, a series of three beeps, which will tell me that, okay, the exoskeleton is going to move now.
So now he's not controlling from the device, the patient is controlling it himself.
All right, so once the step is once the first step is done, I have to again do a forward tilt.
So at this stage, the patient is triggering the walk themselves. So they figure out what they are comfortable with, and they start the process of going ahead with the walk.
Do an end step. Yeah.
Okay. So I'll end the step over here.
So once you reach the end of the walkway, we can the protocol is that you lift the patient, you turn them around, and they can walk backwards.
So there are so many parts of walking that we sort of take for granted. We walk every day. So once we grow up, we sort of assume, you know, a lot of things is just understood. So things like shifting weight, things like how you walk on a slower surface, how you walk on a smoother surface, how you walk in different angles. A lot of these things that we take for granted is something that a patient has to relearn in terms of applying all those stuff.
Now the exoskeleton was doing a slow step walking. So this is where we assume that the patient has a good amount of recovery, he has good upper body strength and is able to maneuver pretty good.
We'll do a few steps of fast speed walking. Ready?
Essentially, there are two motors, is it? So, there are two motors at the knee, and there is a motor for the BWS for it to move. For the body, four primary motors.
So, the ankle is passive. Right now, we have kept a human equivalent ankle stiffness. It's passive right now. So, it has a small range of motion that is allowed over there.
So, 2 degrees of freedom system.
Servo motors.
So this is wherein it's a fast walk.
So this guy is a healthy guy. Yeah. What happens if you resist?
Oh, if I resist.
What happens if you resist? I just explain. So right now it's a trajectory wherein it just follows a fixed trajectory, and this is for completely paralyzed patient. What we need to do, which we are working on, which should take another month or two, is what we call as an adjustable mode. In adjustable mode, it takes what is the power given by the patient and it only adds on a delta. Right? So that way, if it's a completely healthy person, he should be able to walk, you know, by himself without the motor adding on too much of power.
Especially stroke, when they're having the same problem.
So we can do a demonstration of the sit to stand exercises.
So remember, everything is in coordination. So as he sits, the BWS moves back in coordination. So all of that thing has to happen in coordination.
So we'll do a stand motion. Stand, 3, 2, 1, go. Do one more round.
Yeah.
Sit, 3, 2, 1, go.
You adjust the speed of getting up and getting down, yes, depending on the patient.
Okay. So we always start things slowly, and depending on how comfortable they are, that is something that we can adjust.
And there's nothing for the ankle.
Today there's nothing.
No.
The ankle is passive. In this version, the ankle is passive.
But you do have.
We have ideas in terms of adding on something to the ankle.
Talking about this exoskeleton for quite some time now, and for various reasons, I have not been able to personally study the device. One thing is very clear. Now here we have a paraplegic patient whom we are trying to make it walk, and this is the first time we are trying it out in India. And from a neuroscience angle, we know how complicated what we take for granted normally walking is. You know, each step involves so much of activity on one side, so much of relaxation on the other side. At the same time, you know, even just a bending of the forearm requires not only bending of this, but the opposite muscles should relax in a very coordinated way so that there is a smooth action. Now the paraplegic patient will not only sometimes be paralyzed, sometimes the legs will be very stiff. They are like pillars. So even this bending movement itself will sometimes not be possible. So making a paraplegic walk is an extremely complicated task, and it involves too many options, too many devices, too many parameters are there, and I'm sure you have worked on all of these things, because here we have a normal human being, but when you have a paraplegic patient, or sometimes when they are extremely stiff, Dr. Maheshwarappa would know about this, no? It has to be tailor-made for each patient.
Yes, that earlier pilot study when we did, when patient has severe spasms especially, yeah. The device would stop that movement.
So all I can say is we need to congratulate Dr. Kedar and his team for an innovative Indian venture, because we are offering it at a much, much lesser cost than any Western device of this thing can do. So good wishes for all your enthusiasm and your efforts.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.